I always call her mom recently. I knew her when we were classmates during our high school days. She is so beautiful. She is so, because she's very active. I remember her portraying the Blessed Virgin Mother.
She was very plain, but she was prettier with that plain face.
She was the tallest girl, the tallest child in the party, and she was very pretty.
Allergic ako sa pangit sapagkat nature at culture ng Pilipino yon. Alam mo ba ang Pilipino, iba eh, sa ibang lahi. German, English, Spanish. They will say, Guten Morgen, Guten Abend, Buenos Dias, Buenos Tardes. Good morning, good afternoon. In Tagalog, they will not say that. Magandang maga po, magandang tanghali po, magandang gabi po, maganda, maganda. I'm brainwashed by my culture and nature to be beautiful. Kaya allergic ang mga Pilipino, hindi lang ako sa pangit. You cannot be a fruit unless you become a flower and a beautiful thing first. You have to be a flower first, blooming like a beautiful flower before you will be a fruit. You have to be a flower first before you are a fruit. You have to be beautiful first before you can be a fruit. Beauty is not for conquest. Beauty is not for seduction. Beauty is for caring, nurturing, loving, mothering of endless love. Beauty is forever. Beauty never loses its value. It's only the good, the true, and the beautiful that will unite a people.
Imelda. Romualdez Marcos was born on July 2, 1929, and Imelda was born the daughter of a woman named Remedios Trinidad, and a father was Vicente Orestes Romualdez.
1 hour after I was born, they made sure I had pictures, because my Lola, who saw me born, she was the first who hugged me and was embracing me. This child is going to be special. This girl is going to be special. So she was even the one to get the photographer to take a picture of this special child.
I was born in Manila.
We were living in front of San Miguel Church. And before that, we were living in Manila. All the houses were so big. And I was a small girl. I hated big houses, you know, because I had to climb up. I could hardly climb.
So my mother, since we were living downstairs of the house, because we were still small and I did not know to go to the second floor, my mother fixed up so beautifully a part of the garage. And I loved that place so much because my mama had little tables, little chairs, and then parabang toyland house. She made it so beautiful. It was so beautiful. That is the best thing I remember of that big house.
I like the place going to Ermita in Mabini, because early in the morning our yayas would bring us to Rojas Boulevard, and we would be by the seashore. And doon kami pinapasyal every morning.
Anim kami, my youngest sister was around 3 months old pa lang.
I remember we were so used to be having our breakfast served so early at a given point and time. Everything was in order. Our clothes were ready when my mother was there. Our house was so beautifully put together. Everything was so perfect. There was music, there was good food. In short, as a young girl, I had my senses developed to the fullest. Suddenly, everything was gone.
Thank you.
when you become orphan from your mother, you seem to lose everything.
The fact that she lost her mother at the age of 8, that has a tremendous impact on a person, no? The absence of a mother in your life and what her mother went through.
After I lost my mother, we had about a dozen servants at home. But we would go to school. There was no bread on the table because there was not one putting this together. And not even a dress sometimes to wear because they had not laundered our clothes. And all of these terrible things.
Mother only for 8 years, and the greater portion of my life I have no mother. But I still feel her, and the older I have become, the more I feel my mother, the more how intimate her love for me has become, and the more how great a contribution she has given me for what I am. No.
When my mother passed away, I was 8 years old. My father brought the whole family to Leyte. Was really going to another world.
Naisip niya dahil nakita niya dahil gusto niya kung hanap buhay daw siya na hanap buhay tapos sino-sino siya lang mag-aalaga sa amin. So yung ama ko, siya ang gusto mag-aalaga sa amin.
At the age of 8, I knew how to cook, wash clothes, you know everything, because when you lose your mother, You lose everything.
Araw-araw, iba-iba, ito, meron turno-turno sila pagluto. Sila pinapaluto. Miski meron maid, sila in charge na pagluto. Mas masarap yung soup ng dalawa kapatid ko, pero si ma'am, yung upo lang. Kaya minsan, sabi niya, Papa, kami itong soup mo, pampaihi lang ito. Yan palaging biro ng tatay ko sa kanya.
You want coconut, you want to eat, you can have gabi there, then the fish is there, and then you have tomatoes outside. Just all here.
Here I saw that the Lord created pala paradise. Right here in this sea, the biggest battle in naval history was fought. Thousands and thousands of people, of soldiers, Japanese and Americans, dead. I saw here the best, and paradise in heaven too, but the worst.
When General MacArthur landed in the Philippines, he lived in a house across our home in Gran Capitan. And so he would come every morning to walk around and exercise. One morning he heard a girl singing. And then when he saw me, he said, "Was that you singing?" I said, "Yes, General." He said, "Come on, sing again. I want to know if you were the ones who really sang the song. So 2-3 days after, Irving Berlin came to town and he had me called right away, "Imelda, sing with this guy." I did not know him and I did not know who was Irving Berlin anyway. He said, "Imelda, sing before this man. He's a great musician." So I sang, "God bless the Philippines, land that I love, stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above." After the song was over, he said to me, "Imelda, that is not God Bless the Philippines." I said, "No, my teacher taught me that that is God Bless the Philippines." He said, "No, because I composed the song. I'm Irving Berlin who composed the song God Bless America."
With the enemy's airfields under almost constant attack, GIs of the 37th Infantry and 1st Cavalry Division closed in on the capital city from the north. By February 4th, both divisions were moving through the suburbs and were ready for the crucial battle. The streets of Manila turned quickly into a battleground.
My first year high school was in the Leyte High because it was a public school, because it was the first school after liberation that opened.
We were members of the choir, school choir, and then we used to sing in the church.
He is a good friend, very charitable, very generous to us, very faithful, especially to me.
She was a bubbling student, and usually when there are programs, she was the one always selected as the muse.
After high school, I decided, wawal man daddy ko. So there was an opening then for high school graduates to teach in the Chinese school.
We were co-teachers. She was teaching kindergarten, and I was teaching grade 3.
They placed me in grade 1, and all my classmates were in grade 3, 4, 5, and even 6. I said, my grade naman, sir, is not the lowest. Why am I in grade 1? I remember the principal's name then was Dr. Kiang. Dr. Kiang said, Imelda, he said, our best teacher, the most charming, we put in grade 1 because we are opening the minds of the children to education and knowledge. I promise you, when I went there to his office, I was this tall. But when I left out, I was 10 feet tall.
Her beauty alone attracts the children, and her passionate for children, her love for children, and the way she handles children makes their class happy.
When I was freshman in the Divine Word University here in Tacloban,
she ran for president of the Supreme Student Council College.
I was the campaign manager.
We, the education students, we composed the most number of population in the St. Paul's College. So that was her ace already.
We could not imagine her winning against a candidate who was a candidate from the College of Law. They're lawyers, I mean, qualification-wise, they should win.
So she had to meet friends. She had to meet the voters.
The College of Law, with very few enrollees, could not beat the candidate of the College of Education.
Imelda was able to top the election and win.
The College of Law, natalo namin.
That's why she became our president.
President of the Student Council.
My father said, well, if she wins, I'll resign. I won't. He resigned.
I remember seeing her first, always on top of a float. Whatever, where there was a need for a float, Imelda was always the best face, the most beautiful face on top of the float.
Naging Miss Tacloban. Yan ang pinakamaganda sa Tacloban nung araw.
Her father was very, very strict.
Hindi nakakapanligaw ang mga ano, kaya strict ang tatay.
His strictness was a different kind of strictness. Like, it was more preventive than even when, and than punishment.
Mrs. Marcos cannot see a movie.
I was not allowed to go dates, to go partying. No, I was very... We were made to stay home most of the time.
Even the boyfriend, the men friends, so he has to select people.
My father was a tall, good-looking, almost, because he was Spanish, 6'2". Before the war, he was bringing 5,000 pesos to buy a Packard, which was like a Cadillac before a Packard. And the agent of the Packard was in Estrella del Norte, a jewelry shop. He was watching around. There were so many jewelries there. So he said to the lady there, the sales girl, said, Senora, that's a beautiful one. He looked at him from head to toe, and then when he saw his foot, he was in a corcho only, because his chin and all of that. She did not make pansin him.
And again, Senora says, can I see those? Said, no, es muy caro ese. And then, pero Senora, ¿cuánto cuesta ese? 5,000. He took the money in his pocket, dámelo. And he bought the 5,000 necklace that he saw. He came home, not with a pocket, with a necklace. And this was about 1940.
After teaching in Chinese school, Daniela Romaldez used to visit us in the Chinese school. She used to bring fruits to us, and then she will, the last time, she told Imelda to go to Manila.
My father did not like for me to be popular and all of that, but it was no fault of mine, he knew. Just like I found out one day, I was chosen to be the Rose of Tacloban. One day, I found out that my teacher's husband took a picture of mine and handed it over in the Miss Manila Miss Universe contest.
Back in the 1940s, it was like American Idol. It was beauty, poise, brains, and ballot.
The first one that was chosen that Lacson did not like was money contest.
So you could vote for who you wanted. So it didn't matter at all what you look like. You could look like a Carabao. But as long as your dad was Mayor Carabao and your mom was Governor Carabao, hala, Carabao land will vote for you. And that's how the provincial Imelda lost in Manila.
And then Mayor Lacson was insisting that it would be Imelda because Imelda looks great.
The mayor took the crown away from the winner, Norma Jimenez, and now gave it to the Rose of Tacloban, Imelda.
He said, I am mayor of Manila and I want somebody, the first Miss Universe, to represent us beautifully.
Because it was the first time in Philippine history that there were two Miss Manila serving one term.
When I got to Manila, the first few months, I was in a controversy again. And of course, a year or two after, another big controversy because I got married to Ferdinand Marcos after 11 days.
11 days with Dakman lang. 11 days. 11 days lang.
She deserved to be married to somebody who is known. But in fact, she saw him delivering the commencement address to our school, the Leyte High School, in the year 1948.
And we were very impressed with him. Only everybody said, and everybody had a crush and wanted to meet with him. And when they were asking me to join them, I said, no, he's too old. From a closer view, he looked quite good. I found him attractive. When we met in Congress, when I was passing for my cousin, the Speaker of the House, when he saw me, in 20 minutes, he proposed marriage. The shock of my life, I said, you don't know me from Adam, and I don't even know you from Adam, and you're proposing marriage. Oh, he said, but this is really, 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 this is the first time, and I'm not a young man, he said, this is the first time. I'm so in love. This is love at first sight.
Good evening, Mr. Romualdez.
Magandang gabi sa inyo.
Imelda, gusto ko rin makakilala yung aking katunggali.
Hindi naman katunggali.
Everything. Isang ko yan.
Alam ko, Daniling. Ikinagagada po kayong makilala.
Hello?
Maaari ko ba kayong makatayo sandali? Iyan naman eh, kung hindi kayo magagali.
Time, so thinking that I was perfect.
And he trusted my sensitivity completely. I've quite a number of suitors, but I never saw anybody so in love with me. He could not eat anymore, he could not sleep. We were in the roadside cafe, I think in Baguio, and he ordered a chicken in a basket, French fries basket, and me too one. And then I was eating my chicken and finished also the basket, and he had not touched it. And I said, are you going to eat your chicken? And he said, oh no, I cannot eat. My heart is so full of love for you, etc. I said, my gosh. So I said, are you not eating the chicken? You want it? He gave it to me. That luncheon, I ate two chicken, two basket. He did not notice it. I always reported to my father, who was the latest guy courting me, etc., etc., and who he was. He always got the full report. In the case of Ferdinand, because it went so fast, the Speaker of the House was my cousin, Daniel, wired him that Ferdinand and Imelda got married. And he answered, he said, recibió su telegrama con mucho violencia, with much violence. So it was like the Montague and the Capulets, you know, fighting. Right then and then, political dan, kagad. So controversy na naman yung marriage ko.
They have a, she has 11 diamonds in her wedding ring, 10 for the courtship, 11 for the wedding day.
We were so happy for her. She's going to marry a Senate president.
Of the Liberal Party, and my family was on the other side, the Nacionalista Party. He said, if I had 1 million more, and 1 million was big money then, in 1959, he said, I can top the senatorship, and if I top the senatorship, I might become president afterwards. True enough, he gathered titulo very high. He went to the commercial banks to borrow money with that as collateral. He said, we can lend you the money, but it will take 3 months by that time. So we could tapos ng eleksyon. So what I did, I went to Monte de Piedad. I took all my earring, my engagement ring, my bracelet, everything I had. Do you know in 10 minutes, my engagement ring, he gave me 1 million, exactly what Ferdinand did in 10 minutes, with the 1 million pesos in 1959. Marcus was so overwhelmed, he was almost in tears. Never mind, Imelda, he said. From now on, I'll buy you all the diamonds you want, he said.
Imelda knew how to do the one thing that would clinch the presidency. Imelda could sing.
She loves to sing.
She was really a singer.
All my life, I leave you beyond reason. My darling.
And so it's because of Imelda's talent and beauty that Marcos would use her as his secret weapon.
I attracted the crowd. I was like a magnet. And Marcos captivated the crowd.
using her and carting around the countryside to sing for the people as their star and slave. And the Filipino would come out of the dark jungles, because there's no electricity there, and go to the town plaza to watch this beautiful woman sing.
Wala na akong boses, wala na akong maibigay. Tumitila ako ng gusto, pero ang pakpakan ang lakas-lakas.
And subsequently give her husband their vote.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it. It's gotta be rock and roll music. If you wanna
be married 11 days after, and then our difference was 11 years.
His
I was a daughter of 11 children, and in the 11th year he was president. Immediately after the inauguration of the president in 1966, January 1, in Luneta, we were brought here. And I must confess that when I arrived here, I was a bit disappointed that it was not as beautiful and as I imagined it to be as a child. It so happened there was also a typhoon just at the beginning of the term of the president, just before. And there were so many things falling apart. We had at least 50 basins to catch up the water all over the place.
Kadiri nga dito eh. Pero ngayon, sabi nila pag high tide medyo tumataas. Pero noon talaga, grabe. Tapos puro putikan dito.
We did a lot of changes and made it a little bit more presentable. Sometimes very difficult for me was every time there were tourists and they were going to tour them around the palace, they were always very proud of this chandelier that came from this country and so on and so forth. There was so much story about the chandelier that it was imported and all. We're proud of something that is not ours. So what I did was got Jose from Pampanga and make bigger chandeliers made by Filipinos and made by Philippine wood. Eleven is one of our lucky number, plus seven also,
right.
Because he won the nomination for in the Nationalist Party 777. And his opponent was 444, so 7 and 4 again, 11. So we don't believe so much in these things, but there are no coincidences. Things do happen with a reason. There was a luna here. I don't know where. My children grew up in the palace. Imelda, I think, was 8, Bongbong was 6, and Irene was 4. Si Amy, I'm very proud of her, very independent, nakakatuwang bata. Irene is a very disciplined girl, very correct, very proper. Bongbong is very sensitive, profound, and brilliant boy.
So, nung dumating kami, parang di nila alam kung anong gagawin sa maliliquat na makukulit na bata. I think they were used to at least teenagers who were fairly well-behaved. And they had never had a jock president who thought nothing of exercising in the ceremonial hall.
Thank you.
remembering this place? This is where I learned to play judo.
Judo.
Yep. It was Bonganan.
Because judo. we didn't have the mats, the proper mats. So the only place in the palace where there was something that we could fall on was here.
That was the family dining room over there.
The room with the most lamok of any room in the world.
Presidential lamok.
Mm-hmm. Presidential
giant size. And very aggressive.
They called it presidential lamok because they were so big.
So we'd watch all the cowboy movies na lang sa Cinderella. And then he keeps correcting war movies.
Except for
mali naman yan eh. Laging mali yung war movie.
And then nung nauso yung
si Audie Murphy. Audie Murphy,
yung malapad na cinema. Before it was the cinema was only like this. When it was cinemascope already, the chandelier was in the way. So we would watch the movie with the chandelier.
We always watched half a war movie.
This is the most decorated American.
Audie Murphy.
He has 23 medals. Marcos, a Filipino, has 32 medals, and all his medals are fake. Ano naman yun? Kawawa naman tao.
No, one of my best memories was when Vic Morrow and Rick Jason came of combat. That was the biggest thrill that we had because they came to the palace.
You and Daddy were beside yourself.
And we were all the kids, all the my friends. Well, I was
Daddy
the most
too.
Sikat guy of all.
Send them to England so that nobody will know who they are and what is the position. In fact, some picture like this was seen by his classmate, and his classmate said, "Hey, your father must be a minister of a church because this seems to look like a cathedral." My son Bongbong said, No, my father is a president." "Oh, your father is a president? My father is also president of an electric company in our town."
The one in England was that I died. And then they replaced me.
You like that story? You're telling
no,
everyone.
No, everywhere I go, they ask me the same question. And I don't, you know, I've run out of ways how to answer it. I mean, what do you say? How do you prove that you are yourself? Diba? And it was crazy. It just got to that point that a cousin-in-law came to me and finally said, "Yeah, you know, you're the real one pala."
Pagpunta ko sa probinsya, pagpunta ko sa Tondo, sa lugar ng mahihirap at sa baryo, I will dress up for 2 hours. Because, first of all, not only for respect, because they are looking for a star in the dark of the night.
Hindi yan nagpapamake up kahit kanino. Isa lang.
Eh, ang uso pa naman noon yung, ano ba yung mga hair doon na nakatis na puro mga parang diki na nakapatong dito sa ulo. Beehive dito, saka twist dito sa likod. Tapos pupulputin mo yung buhok yan. Ang laki-laki at taas-taas. Ayun ang hairdo niya noon.
Mrs. Marcos is walking with beautiful shoes and perfect hair. And my dad was holding her hand. And I was like, walking in the mud with high heels, you know, only Mrs. Marcos.
He calls me sweetheart, darling, and he never called me by my name. And
how do you call
every
me?
Time there was a full moon, he would pull me from here, from the office here, and pull me towards the balcony and show me the full moon. Yeah. He was a very romantic guy, yeah.
How do you call him?
Well, sweetheart, darling, also Andy and all of that. But he hardly called me Imelda, or he was very affectionate. And as I said, very romantic. I remember very well when one of the Muslim
rebels did surrender here at the room of the president, and he was looking at the palace so big, and then he asked the president, "Sir, this house is very big. How many wives do you have?" And then Marcos said, "One wife, of course." He said, "But the house is so big, you should have more wives." And this Muslim rebel said, "I have 72, and you have one wife, and your house is so big. Well, you should see my wife." So he called the aide, called the first lady. Then I was brought there in front of this Muslim rebel, and then he said, "See, my wife, one is enough with this kind of wife, et cetera, et cetera." The Muslim rebel looked at me from head to toe, on and on. And after a while, he said to the president, "It's still much better to have more wives." So this has so many memories, and I thank the Lord for giving me the privilege of being First Lady for more than 20 years.
My first project was the water of
When I was looking for a place to build it, there was no place that I could put a monument to the Filipino spirit. Why? Because I discovered Manila was owned by 10 families. Manila was owned by 10 families.
Manila was owned by 10 families.
10 families.
She was actively involved in the CCP. This was really her baby.
How was I going to build this when the budget of the Philippine government then was barely $500 million?
She found ways to finance. So in many ways, the CCP was pampered then.
When I had the Cultural Center Foundation title, I went to a bank and borrowed money, 35 million pesos, to start the cultural center.
She would organize meetings and said, "Let's have a fundraising."
So finally, when I was in front of the cultural center, Mr. Rockefeller, "Here will rise the cultural center of the Philippines," I told him. "But there is water, Mrs. Marcos." "Oh, Mr. Rockefeller, first year I covered that with soil, second year I drive the piles, third year the building will rise, and fourth year the curtain will rise." He looked at me like I was La Mancha and said, "Mrs. Marcos, it took the Rockefellers, patrons of the United States government, 16 years to build the Lincoln Center. If you can only cover that with soil in the next 4 years that your husband is president, I'll take my hat off to you." Then in 69, a month before the president's birthday, September 11, I wired Mr. Rockefeller, "Mr. Rockefeller, the curtain rises at the Cultural Center of the Philippines, and the inauguration will be on the eve of President Marcos' birthday." And he was about to come, he was eager to come. He accepted invitation to inaugurate the Cultural Center. Unfortunately, on his way, he had a very bad laryngitis problem, had to be flown back. But when he saw the brochure of what the Cultural Center had become, said, "Mrs. Marcos, perhaps it was better I could not come, because I would not have been able to bring enough hats to take off." So this cultural center is a monument to the Filipino spirit, with the genesis of Malakas and Maganda, that beauty is for mothering and power is for peace.
Because really, we have to thank Imelda for putting our identity out there. In the 1950s and 60s, when you said the word Philippines, nobody even knew where it was, right? Oh, you're from the Philippines. Do you speak Filipinese? How are things going on in Central America, right? Until the cultural center of the Philippines was coming, came along. Because this was the institution in charge of the Filipino public persona.
Built this coconut palace to prove that you can even make a palace out of coconut. And I use every part of the coconut here. And we had an outstanding Filipino architect, the Manosas, to put this together. Because this strait is a strait we're in the Pacific Ocean, that is 32% of the world's surfaces, rushes into this strait. And so the currents are very strong. So many relatives of ours from Samar who would come from Samar to come to Leyte would sometimes leave early in the morning. Some of them will be there in 2 hours. But some of them would never come at all. So I went to Marcos to say, I told Ferdinand, I said, Ferdinand, we better, you know, put a bridge there if you can. Marcos initially was very reluctant, but because of the fact that it was going to be very expensive, about hundreds of millions of pesos. But then I said, but Ferdinand, you know, this bridge will not only connect Leyte and Samar, but it will be the starting point of a connection between Mindanao and Luzon.
The entire story of people being left buried in the foundation because Imelda had ordered the continuation of the construction without the bodies being retrieved was a urban legend. In the beginning, I believed what was said about Imelda, about this film center. So rushing it so that, you know, the building became kind of skimpy or it became unstable and all of that. That might have been true. I started searching for people. I went on the human trail, on the people trail, and fortunately, most of those who were involved in the construction are still alive. I didn't find any evidence that she actually ordered, you know, the continuation of the construction of the film center, even while bodies were still buried there.
The reason I am so in a hurry in making the heart center, when I was making the heart center, lung center, kidney center, this, I would say 70 days, the folk art theater, this one in 3 months, this one. I made it fast because when I saw suffering, it hit me here. Because I knew what it was to suffer because I had no mother. I knew. So I became very passionate in all my projects. Not only build the building, but also reclaim the land. I reclaimed land from the sea. Yung dagat-dagatan, foreshore land. Nung may lupa na ako, walang bahay. Nung may bahay na, walang ilaw. Nung may ilaw na, walang tubig. Walang kalye. Walang ganito. Nung may basic services na, wala naman pambayad ng basic services. Edukasyon, wala. So nag-KKK naman ako.
I established parks, basketballan, concert at the park, international film festival. Lahat yun, you had to intervene.
She loved to talk about culture. Actually, we think differently, or we thought differently, so that's why I was fascinated by it. I kind of tend to think, and this is already the words of Mrs. Marcos. She used to say that some people think, you know, along a straight line, you know, this leads to that, this leads to that, and she said that she thinks kind of in a circular, not really circular, but kind of a wavy manner.
Hindi siya malapit kasi sa mga writers eh. Ang kanya talagang barkada, mga
visual arts
saka music and dance because of kasilag. Ang dream namin talaga noon, pagkaraang mabasa ng bata ang 500 titles, grade 5 na utak niya. Ganun yun, yun ang aming dream noon. Grade 5 na yung utak niya. Sa formal education. Kasi may history yun, may science, may folklore, original stories, mga ganon. Kompleto. At yun yung naging Adarna Children's Book Project.
My aunt is really very meticulous. She's really a mom. She's like my second mom. And That's why I could see that even when I stayed in the palace, sometimes I'd wake up about 1, 2 in the morning, you know, and I'd see her, she's still walking around.
No, first lady ako, at pumupunta na ako sa iba't ibang puok ng mundo.
Ako ang pampayang sa buhaya. Well, because he knew that I could execute it successfully because I not only knew the solution, but I could smell the problem, I could see the problem, I could touch it and all of that because of my senses. Chairman Mao. Mao was a man, I was a woman. He was a communist, I was not. He was old and I was young then. So what I did was I took his hand and made mano, respect him. The Filipino way of giving respect is mano. When I made mano, he grabbed my other hand and kissed it. And the world asked him, Mao, why did you kiss Mrs. Marcos' hand? He said, when Mrs. Marcos respected me, in turn, I respected her, admired her, and loved her. Mrs. Mao Tse-tung asked Chairman Mao, Chairman Mao, why is it when we talk and Mrs. Marcos' name is mentioned, why is it you become happy and smiling? He said, I like Mrs. Marcos. I admire her a lot because she is so natural and that is perfection. See, perfect daw ako. In Cuba, Fidel Castro was driving me around the sugar fields and he was tediously telling me how difficult it was to bring water to the sugar fields. Presumptuously, I said, oh, Comandante, that's very easy to bring water to the sugar fields. We in the Philippines, we just put canals from the rivers and bring it to the sugar fields or to the rice fields. Imelda said, we cannot do that. We cannot build canals from the rivers because we have no rivers. I said, why have no rivers? No tenemos ríos porque no tenemos montañas. They have no mountains. Saddam Hussein was the first leader in the Arab world who really brought Philippine labor to the Middle East. Muammar Gaddafi, after I was left by General Ramos and Enrile there, because they were threatening to blow up our plane in
Tripoli. You know, my mission was there, ceasefire, only one. I came back with them. I said to Marcos, Ferdinand, you know, Gaddafi was only 24 years old when he became president. And you know, Ferdinand, when he's riding a horse, he looks like a man, you know, like Lawrence of Arabia. And you know, Ferdinand, if you see him, when he smiles, his teeth is very white. Ang ganda ng ngipin. Sabi naman ni Marcos sa akin, why? Are you buying a horse? Hindi ko alam, no? Kung bibili ka palang kabayo, titingan mong ngipin. Yung pala nagje-jelly na si Sir. We stayed in the palace for 20 years. Then came the 20 years of deprivation, persecution, ridicule, suffering, deprivation, name it, and we had it.
But you have to remember that back in 1986, Corazon Aquino, the incoming president, was only one player among many. Because really, you have to remember that the revolution was not instigated by Cory. It was instigated by disgruntled former secretary Juan Ponce, who now with Fidel Ramos was so dissatisfied by President Marcos's blatant cheating that they decided to hold the coup d'etat. People power ensued, and President Marcos and Imelda were swept out into Hawaii, and Cory Aquino became the next president.
Kinidnap kami. We did not run away from our country. We were kidnapped out of our country. Wala man lang kami need $1 na dala. Yung kasama namin, meron 16,000 pesos. Eh, doon kami linanding una sa Guam. Binili namin ng gatas kasi lahat ng mga bata eh kailangan ng gatas ni botelya ng gatas wala. Kasi pupunta lang kami sa Pawai. Yung pala Hawaii ang labas.
Well, of course, because he was first lady, but the way they were driven out of the country, of course, I felt sympathy.
We were left completely without anything. And when we went to America, not even a dollar. Unang tinirahan namin sa isang doon sa kampo ng hikam para kami doon mo kakahiyan sabihin. Ando doon sa isang hangar. Doon kami kumakain, may sulmo sundalo.
When I learned that they were in Guam, I wanted to fly to Guam. But to at least be there with them. And a friend of mine cautioned me, hindi pwede kang pumunta doon, hindi ka papapasukin sa hikam. So I waited for them to get to Hawaii. And that's what I did when they were in Hawaii. The first thing I did was take the flight to Hawaii and visit them.
Naku, when we was in Hawaii, during her birthday, we will call her up. Sabi niya, she's crying. I am here alone with my husband. Nobody calls me. The blue ladies does not call anymore. And stop ang mga telephone. Ang mga classmates ko in Tacloban is the one calling me.
Salamat na lang. Maraming Pilipino doon nagdadala ng asin, nagdadala ng ista, araw-araw yun, lahat ng Pilipino nagpipila, lalo mga Ilocano nando doon. Grabe talaga. Kleenex, television pa nagbibigay.
Sabi niya, aadi ako alone with my husband. And then, I do not know when can I go home. Nasaan siya? My husband is here. Nobody is calling us except my friends in Tacloban.
The first time I visited her, I barely sat down, and as soon as I sat down, actually, she said, Raul, why don't you play the piano, please? lowest point of their political career, and yet she wanted to hear some music.
Because you have to remember that what happened in 1986 was not a revolution, it was a class war. And what happened was that the old order won, and out went the new society, and in came the order of the Philippine landed oligarchy, as represented by the Haciendera Coriaquino, and the whims of the Catholic Church, as represented by Jaime Cardinal Sin. The same people who've run this country since the times of Jose Rizal.
The PCGG assists the president in her task of the recovery of ill-gotten wealth as mandated by Executive Order No. 1, issued by President Aquino on February 28, 1986. To recover the so-called ill-gotten wealth as defined or in contemplation of Executive Order No. 1,
ang nagiging ill-gotten sila, hindi. Imagine, pinagbili yung mga top buildings sa New York. Tapos, kinukuha yung pera.
I just implement the law together with our statutory council, official council. This is the Solicitor General's Office, which is the Council of the Republic.
And what they did, they exhumed and got the bones of my parents and family was all sprawled all over the place looking for gold. Mas mahalaga pala ang gold sa tao.
I just present the evidence that we have, whatever is available. Let the court decide.
All my paintings and all the icons, do you know that they sold it and nothing was left?
Such a pity that these treasures would be sold only to be snapped up by major museums in Italy, leaving us with nothing.
Ferdinand Marcos was dead in 89, and they filed a case against me. And can you inherit, even if it was a criminal, you don't inherit a crime.
Merong criminal cases lahat ng aking apo, miski 2 months old.
I was with my aunt throughout the trial when my uncle passed away. I went to Hawaii and I stayed with my aunt.
The first day I was in trial in New York, I wore a Filipino dress. And it was almost winter and very cold, and I did not even wear a gown. So when they interviewed me, Mrs. Marcos, why are you wearing an evening gown? It's almost a flimsy evening gown. And then when it is almost winter, I was not wearing an evening gown. I was wearing my national costume, the Filipino terno, to make a statement with as much dignity, with as much beauty as I could muster, to wear my Filipino dress to tell the world, hi world, I have my own flag, I have my own laws and courts, why am I here?
I really felt bad during the trial. That's why I knew that even we were there when she collapsed, and yeah, and the judge said that, you know, we can move for a continuance, that, you know, the trial doesn't have to continue until you feel better. And she insisted on, you know, continuing and finishing it.
They were giving me a medical severance at the height of the trial. I said, no, give me 1 week. More than life, I value being bigger. I went back. Wala na sana akong kaso. Nakalibre na ako. No. I wanted the truth to prevail. Because money and power, you take only up to the grave. But truth and honor, you bring with you unto infinity.
What we heard from the juries, they prolonged it because they wanted to announce her innocence during her birthday.
I finished the trial in New York.
and I won my case on my birthday. And then they said to me, Mrs. Marcos, are you bitter and angry with America? I said, I have no anger in my heart nor bitterness in my soul because the system worked. God bless America.
Bakit hindi kami pauuwiin sa Pilipinas? Na ang Diyos ang nagutos nito? This is the law of God. This is your land and I cannot go back to my land. This is a land destined to me by God, not by man. Hindi lang kagustuhan ko. Itong bahay na ito, kung kunin nila ito, okay pa. Gawa ko lang ito, tao lang yan. Pero itong lupa na ito, gawa ito ng Diyos. At plinano niya na dito ako mapapanganak, dito ako matitira. Ito ang bayan ko. I could not enter here. The first time I came back from the United States, I came to Ulo. They would not allow me.
Come on, Imelda's back and she's bad and she's got a new jewelry line. And the last time that I saw Imelda was really just a few weeks ago at the SNR Price Smart, eating pizza by the checkout counter in full terno, with Filipinos all around her with a cell phone trying to take a picture with the former First Lady. Dare I say, Imelda is still loved by the Philippine masses. Dare I even say that the Marcoses probably won the elections of 1986. They didn't have to cheat that much.
The image of Imelda Marcos, I don't think there can be anything stronger than that beautiful image of a woman who's so stunning and so powerful.
Now I am even in Imelda collection, wherein I am recycling something that would be junk and would be thrown away to something maybe beautiful, maybe very inexpensive, invaluable, but beautiful. The important thing is beauty.
And Filipino message of hope that even the junk, the garbage, the detritus, the flotsam and jetsam of her sometimes difficult life can be made into something beautiful. Beauty that is Imeldific.
When I was in school in Ilocos, they were like asking for a new word in the dictionary, and then they said Imeldific, and I go like, nice.
Imelda collection guaranteed to tarnish and disintegrate. Be Imeldific, be creative and ingenious, unleash the beauty in you. Yun message yun. Ilabas ang kagandahan sa iyo.
To be in front of the camera, I actually saw her a little more vulnerable, a little more unsure, and it's nice to see people like that because it shows you that they're human and that, you know, it's like, she's not always perfect at every moment, you know? And to me, I think that just made me see how human she really was and how, like, we could relate on a more personable level.
Mom Melody always wanted to be young, and so she, like, Mola sounds old, so she wanted Mom Melody.
What's your beauty secret? What's your... And she said, I don't worry about my problems. I just smile.
I don't believe too much in all this work of surgery, of cosmetics and all of that. I don't use anything artificial, you know. Even now, soap, I use papaya or whatever, or coconut or something. I'm very attached to things natural.
natural, even food.
Saging lang yung inakain niya. Nakikita ko yan, tinitingnan ko. Kwento ng kwento yan, tapos hawak lang saging.
Like for instance, the Japanese, if you will see them, because their land is rock, and they cannot plant too much there. And I remember when I was a little girl during the war, we were made to sing their national anthem, Kimi Ayo Wa Chiyoni Ya Chiyoni. So they have sashimi, sushi, they cannot cook it. But you know, in the end, look, according to the percentage in the world as to who has the most number of old people in reference to their populations, that are the Japanese. Why? Because they eat natural food.
Ihaw lang, ano, kinilaw, because natural. Kung hindi naliluto.
I eat too much, I eat the wrong things, I don't exercise, I don't sleep. I do everything wrong, but I always feel right and beautiful and feel that everything can be made beautiful.
When I promoted the shoe industry in 1969, and they were complaining because there was no help, the molds, they did not have enough leather, I had to import leather from Australia, and then we had the mold from Italy and how to cure the leather and so on and so forth. We were earning about $500,000 a year. Later on, in less than so many years, we had almost $100 million.
Yung shoe industry naman, in grateful appreciation, pag may shoe fair, nagbibigay ng sapatos para regalo in grateful. Pero ang problema, sinusulat, Imelda Romualdez Marcos, First Lady of the Republic of the Philippines, made by Sumac or sino. Di huling-huli, hindi ko pa ginamit, pero bigay sa akin. At ako naman, lahat ng binigay sa akin, hindi ko tinatapos. You must remember what Confucius said. Confucius said, when you are wearing a shoe, you are well healed. And the difference between peasants and royalty are shoes. That's why he was wearing golden shoes. Oh, of course. At saka, medyo okay, parang. But especially, you know, I just won my case, and I won my case, and I was only 60 then, and that was a good 20 years ago, you know. And so, look better and everything, so we were quite good from kings and all of that, you know. But, no, I think I had enough of a great love that will last me unto eternity. And also at the same time, the more I think of Ferdinand, the more perfect he becomes. And the longer he's gone, the more I'm in love with him. And in fact, when he passed away, I could not even cry. I went down to my knees and said, Lord, thank you so much for giving me the privilege of being by the side of this great human being, Ferdinand Marcos. Alam mo, it is funny, kasi yung mga galit sa akin, nagmumura sa akin, ang sungit-sungit, nagiging pangit. Ako naman, parang inosenteng bata, gumaganda ako. So pagkikita namin next time, sila pumangit na, ako gumanda pa. Nakakaawa, huwag ka nang magalit. Kaya kayong may galit sa buhay, huwag kayong magalit kasi papapangit yun. Eh, 18 na ako. And yet,
with all the persecution and all the deprivation and all the ridicule and everything, I still feel that this world is a paradise and heaven too. And I don't have to die to be in heaven. I can be in heaven alive. And this is the feeling I want to share with the world. History will always come out with the truth. You cannot change the truth because truth is God. And when you are on the side of the truth and God, nobody can touch you.